Hello, everyone. My name is Da Yan, and I'm an assistant professor from the Computer Science Department of the University of Alabama at Birmingham. I'm here to present our ICD 2020 paper titled G-Sinker, a distributed framework for mining subgraphs in a big graph. First, let me introduce our target problem. That is to find qualified subgraph instances from a big graph. One example is to mine dense subgraph structures such as cliques, quasi-cliques that requires each node to be connected to the majority of other nodes, and many other dense subgraph definitions. Another example is subgraph matching. We are given a query graph. We want to find the subgraph instances that match it in a big data graph. This query is useful in searching knowledge graphs and biological networks. A key feature of those problems that we target is that the time complexity is high, often because of the giant search space rather than the data volume itself, as in conventional data-intensive analytics. In this slide, we show how we can explore the vertex set of a result subgraph by depth-first backtracking in a set enumeration tree over all possible vertices. This, for example, applies to our click finding problem. To avoid redundancy, we only add new vertices into the set if their IDs are larger than those vertices that are already in the set. For example, to get ABD, we do not grow BD by A, but rather grow AB by D. In traditional single-threaded algorithms, we usually solve these problems by divide and conquer that backtracks on the nodes in our previous set enumeration search tree. Let us illustrate by considering the problem of finding maximal clicks. Specifically, since each clique is a complete graph where each pair of nodes are one hop away, we can construct one hop ego networks around each vertex and find cliques from those subgraphs. If a vertex, say V1, has a high degree and so the subgraph around it is still very big, we can recursively divide it into small overlapping subgraphs for further mining. Now, let's zoom in that subgraph and assume that V1 is already in our result clique. We can then consider two cases. Those cliques containing V3 and those without V3. The pink subgraph assumes V1 and V3 are in our clique already, and we continue mining cliques in this subgraph by kicking out those vertices more than one hop away from V3. For those without V3, we can further divide them into those with V4 and those without V4. The pink subgraph assumes V1 and V4 are already in our clique, and we kick out those vertices more than one hop away from V4 from the subgraph and then continue the mining. We can then continue on the remaining subgraph and divide it further if necessary. In fact, the mining itself follows this recursive procedure and explores our set enumeration tree in depth first order. We next review the related works that tackle this problem. Earlier works use MapReduce for dense subgraph mining problems like triangle counting, but as the TKDD paper in this slide shows, the authors found that MapReduce is not suitable for triangle counting. The fastest MapReduce algorithm at that time takes over 1600 machines for more than 5 minutes to find the triangles of a graph on which the author's single-threaded algorithm only needs half a minute. This is a huge waste of computing resources and energy. Due to the popularity of things like a vertex programming model, there are some works solving dense subgraph mining and graph matching using vertex-centric programs. However, in the vertex-centric paradigm, vertices notify other vertices about their value update by sending messages along hashes, making the execution network I/O bound. Also, the programming is not intuitive for subgraph mining, since vertex-centric programs operate in the unit of vertex and are usually for computing values for vertices, not for finding subgraphs. Recently, a number of systems were proposed for graph mining based on the idea of subgraph-centric programming, which is more intuitive. However, they only address the programming friendliness issue, but not the low efficiency issue, as their execution engines are still I/O bound. N-scale is the first work in this direction, which constructs candidate subgraphs to mine upon around each vertex using k iterations of breadth first search. However, this is conducted by k MapReduce jobs, which makes the process network I/O bound. Each MapReduce job also needs to load and dump a huge amount of intermediate subgraphs via Hadoop digital file system. The subgraphs are then finally distributed for concurrent mining with another MapReduce job, which separates from the curse of the last reducer. Arabisk proposes a user-friendly programming interface for graph mining called embedding-centric program. Here, embedding is a materialized subgraph, and these subgraphs are grown in increasing size for checking. Arabisk is a distributed system where every machine needs to keep an entire data graph in memory, and the subgraph materialization makes it network I/O bound. In contrast, our G-Sinker uses node backtracking in serial mining algorithms as much as possible to avoid the cost of materializing subgraphs. Arabisk's API also covers the problem of frequent subgraph pattern mining, which requires Arabisk to conduct subgraph isomorphism check on every newly materialized subgraph. But such check is not needed in other subgraph mining problems that we consider. Recall that our set enumeration tree perfectly divides the search space and avoids redundancy by comparing vertex IDs. In summary, Arabic's API is simple, but not amenable to efficient execution. Check out our prefix FPM system for a more efficient solution for frequent pattern mining. In fact, removing the slow network communication can speed up the computing, as is done by the upstream system. But as a single machine system running out of core, upstream is still disk I/O bound. Another system, Newry, proposed to find the top K results graphs rather than all of them. But Newry is a single-threaded Java program. All the systems we reviewed so far do not scale their performance with the number of CPU cores they use. For example, on a dataset called YouTube, Newry takes over 1,000 seconds to find the clicks. If you use our G-Sync system on the same graph, which has 1 million vertices, it takes only 9.4 seconds on a multi-core machine. You're welcome to check out our demo on the G-Sync website. As a side note, Frank McSherry has criticized the I/O bound bottleneck of existing big data systems, whose performance is often only comparable to a single CPU core throughput. I started a new paradigm called T-Syncer, or Think Like a Task, which targets high complexity divide and conquer algorithms over big data. The idea is that if your computing cost is superlinear to data size, the cost of computing a task on a subset with data is expensive enough to justify the I/O cost of collecting the data subset. Of course, we should still keep the programming model more general and friendly than using a conventional HPC library. There are many problems amenable to divide and conquer. And here, there are a great amount of real research opportunities for systems researchers. I was a veteran of systems in the vertex-centric paradigm, and my experience tells me that T-Syncer paradigm is the next goldmine. We will also have a new book chapter coming, sharing our experience developing such systems. And you're welcome to check it out. Here is a brief history of our G-Syncer system. G-Syncer was originally a prototype where I proposed a vertex pooling-based subgraph API, but as a prototype, the execution engine is just to make things work, and it does not even have multi-threading support. It also has flawed designs, say, tasks access vertices in Berg synchronized manner, and to reduce memory overhead, subgraphs are saved to disks, but a bad task scheduling strategy leaves many subgraphs on disk, leading to expensive I/O costs. Since a full-fledged G-Syncer system would take time to develop, the student who helped implement the old G-Syncer added multi-threading support and termed the resulting system G-Miner. But it inherits all the flawed designs and leads to poor performance when the input graph gets big. G-Miner follows the same API as G-Syncer. Please check out our new G-Syncer website where you can find great documentation, and my group will provide full technical support. Here's an overview of G-Syncer in a cluster of three machines. G-Syncer loads the input graph from HDFS, where each machine loads a fraction of vertices along with their adjacency lists into a local table. Tasks are initialized from each vertex in the local table, and the task can grow its subgraph by requesting neighboring vertices, or actually their adjacency lists. To allow multiple tasks in a machine to share remote vertices, a remote vertex cache is maintained, but it has a capacity limit to keep memory bounded. Each computing thread maintains a local task queue to keep it busy. This is the key to our scalability to CPU cost. When the task queue is about to be empty, new tasks will be refilled to the queue, while if more tasks need to be added to a full task queue, the last batch of tasks in the queue will be spilled to disk to be refilled by other computing threads later. This allows the memory consumed by tasks to be bounded. Here's an illustration of how vertices are partitioned by the local vertex tables of all machines, which form a distributed key value store where a task can pull the adjacent list of a vertex using its ID. Here's an illustration of the remote vertex cache. For example, while vertex 8 is not in machine M0, if a task on M0 requests vertex 8, it will be pulled to the cache. Note that if another task on M0 also needs 8, it can then directly access it in the cache without sending a duplicate request. Here is a task-centric programming model of G-Syncer. The first user-defined function specifies how a task is spawned from an individual vertex. The second user-defined function specifies how a task grows its subgraph from those surrounding vertices adjacency lists, which are pulled into the frontier array the last time the compute function is called. A task calls compute function in iterations to expand its subgraph until all needed data are ready, after which the task then mines the constructed subgraph. When vertices are being pulled, the task is suspended so that CPU cores can be released to process other tasks. A task can pull a vertex that is on its subgraph boundary. It can also split the subgraph into multiple new tasks for concurrent processing if the subgraph is big. The next question is how to design our remote vertex cache so that tasks can access vertices concurrently while requested vertices can be continuously added from remote. And the vertices no longer needed by tasks can be evicted to make room for new requests. One solution is to hash vertices into different buckets using their IDs so that if two vertices are in different buckets, their processing can happen together. In this slide, we assume vertices are hashed to 10 buckets by hashing their IDs modulo 10. Each bucket is protected by a lock so that only one operation can be carried out each time. A bucket has three containers. Gamma table keeps the adjacency lists. Z table or zero table tracks which vertices are no longer needed by tasks. And R table or request table keeps those vertices that are requested by tasks, but whose adjacency lists are still on their way. We next illustrate how these containers are used. For example, if some tasks requests remote vertices 10 and 11, and their adjacent lists happen to be already in gamma tables, then we simply add their counters by one to indicate that one more task is holding them. Here, vertex 10 is also removed from the table as its counter is no longer zero, and it cannot be evicted anymore. Next, we assume a task finishes a round of compute function and releases its hold of request vertices, such as 12 and 13 here. Then we need to decrement their counters in the gamma table. And since vertex 12's counter becomes zero, it is added to Z table to allow eviction. Now assume a task requests vertices 20 and 21 from our cache, and their adjacency lists are not already in gamma tables. Then we need to add them to R table. Here, 20 is already in R table, and so we simply increment its counter to avoid sending another redundant request, while 21 is a newcomer, and thus the request is added to the sending queue. Note that R table avoids sending redundant vertex requests. Now assume that vertex 22's adjacency list arrived, and in R table, 22 already has three task requests. Then we move this entry along with its counter 3 to gamma table, indicating that three tasks are holding vertex 22. We also have a garbage collector that periodically scans Z tables to evict vertices. That's why we need the small size of Z tables. If we let GC scan the larger gamma tables, it will take a longer time to check each bucket, and hence reducing concurrency. An evicted vertex is removed from both Z table and the gamma table. Next, we look at GSynchronous task management. In this slide, the components in the red box are shared by all computing threads in a machine, including the local vertex table and a list of task files spilled from the task queues of computing threads, both of which are sources of tasks to be refilled into task queues. The black box on the right shows the components for each computing thread, where the third task source is a set of tasks that are waiting for the request data to arrive. We will prioritize our refill by considering the task files first, as these tasks have been partially processed, and we want to finish pending tasks earlier than spawning new tasks to process, in order to minimize the number of disk buffered tasks. Now, let's look at those components inside each computing thread. The task queue keeps a list of tasks to be computed by the current thread, along with their vertices to request for. If the queue has too few tasks, we will refill tasks from one of the previous three task sources. If the queue is full but a new task needs to be added, we will spill the last batch of tasks as a file to disk. Each computing thread pops a task from the head of the queue each time, requests the vertices, and if any of them is not in the cache, it will put the task into the task table shown here to wait for data. We also keep track of how many requested vertices are met. If a vertex response is received, we get the task list of that vertex from the R table. We mentioned we maintain a counter for each R table vertex entry, but we actually maintain the list of task IDs instead to track those tasks that request that vertex. For each task in the task table, we add the map counter, and if the counter reaches all the requested vertex count, we move that task to the task buffer here. Each computing thread keeps calling pop to take tasks for processing and calling push to compute the ready tasks and add them to the task queue if more processing needed. Newly created tasks are also appended to the task queue, and tasks may be spilled to the disk. Remark that if vertex cache or task containers reach their capacity limit, we only repeat the push function to process ready tasks so that vertices can be released from the cache to make room, and pop can then be restored to request more vertices for new tasks. For tasks during between machines, we will estimate the pending tasks in each machine from the capacity of the local vertex table and task files buffered on the disk for deciding effective task dueling plans. tasks stolen from other machines appended to our file list on disk to be refilled into the task queues of computing threads. As you can see here, G-Sinker is orders of magnitude faster than other systems, especially for big graphs. The only competitor is Gminer, which can scale with the number of CPU cores used, but it does not scale well when the graph gets big, due to its bad task scheduling scheme that keeps a lot of partially computed tasks on disks. Thanks for your attention, and please check out our systems online.